Good afternoon. Just before our celebration of Holy Mass, just to make a few brief announcements, just to remind you to turn off your mobile phone. And if you can scan the QR code on your seat for track and trace purposes, that would be greatly appreciated. As you leave the church, we have three exits at the front. So if you can just please filter out the three exits as opposed to just using the one that we're all inclined to use at the centre. So the three doors at the back will all be open when it's time to leave after Mass.
St. Patrick, dear saint of our isle, on arms I for children bestow a sweet smile. And now thou art high in thy mansions above, on Erin's green valleys, look down in thy love. On Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, look down in thy love. Hail, glorious St. Patrick, thy words were once strong against Satan's wiles and an infidel throng. Not less in thy might where in heaven thou art. Oh, come to our aid and our battle take part. On Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, look down in my love. In the war against sin, in the fight for the faith, dear Saint, may thy children resist unto death. May their strength be meekness in penance and their prayer, their banner the cross which they glory to bear. On Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, on Erin's green valleys, look down in my
In life, Peter treasured the gospel of Christ. May Christ now greet him with these words of eternal life. Come, blessed of my Father. In baptism, Peter received the sign of the cross. May he now share in Christ's victory over sin and death. Please be seated for the eulogy.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can I begin with a few thanks? Father Bernard, thank you for letting me say a few words about Peter, and yet again for your support for our family in their time of need. You've been incredible, thank you. Can I also thank all of you, particularly those who have travelled from as far afield as America, England, Jersey and Ireland, as well as everyone watching online. Your love and kindness have kept Rosalind, Grace, Anne-Marie going. I want to also thank some people who have made this day very special. To the funeral directors, Alex, above and beyond for your old pal. To our wonderful musicians for today and also for keeping Peter going during lockdown. And to Susan and Gillian at the Beechwood. The family have also asked me to say a special thank you to two people, to Doctors John Ballantyne and Andrew Blair. They latterly took over Peter's care and were amazing. They gave him that most wonderful of gifts, hope. Ultimately, it wasn't to be, but it wasn't for the lack of trying, so thank you both. Peter Gilday was born in Glasgow on the 16th of August 1956 to his beloved parents, Anne and Donnie. He always asserted, though, that he was conceived in County Donegal, so that made him a proud Irishman. He carried that love of Ireland right to the end. We would often talk about his childhood and how he thought it was wonderful. In Glasgow, being the baby of the family, he was surrounded by his older siblings, his sister Maureen, the boss, and his brothers Eddie, James, John and Patrick. He also had the enormous benefit of the love of a second mum in Auntie Betty, as well as a legion of aunts, uncles and cousins. Then every year he would get to spend the entire summer with his third mum, Auntie Ellen, her husband Dinny, and all his other cousins in Anagra, County Donegal. Anagra, with Sharkey's Bar, was always his spiritual home. He was so happy to get back there in July to see and stay with his brother Eddie, an event that made them all the more happy by the arrival of his nephew Danny, who'd come all the way from New York City to surprise him. When Peter left school, he went to work with his father and best pal Donny. He always said to me that it was the happiest time of his working life, and he learned everything from his dad. It subsequently gave him great satisfaction that he then taught all his nephews everything that they know. Danny, Edward, James, John and James, when I say everything, Peter meant everything you know. A few years later, a job opportunity came up in Germany, so Peter, his brother Patrick and cousin Eddie McGrath went over to work there. An eventful trip that culminated in the boys taking all their German colleagues out for a farewell libation. One drink led to another, and another, and another. They woke up in the morning to realise they didn't have enough money to get home, and during a phone call home to Manswood, it was suggested that Peter unstitch the lining of his jacket pocket. Having done so, they found that Auntie Betty had sewn in a quantity of notes, and the contingency fund was enough to get them all home. Utter class. The next 4 decades would take Peter all over Britain and Ireland, and working with his family in particular meant a lot to him. His final job saw him reuniting with his brothers James and Patrick at Scottish Water. The job was to see the three of them through to retirement together. It was not to be. With the loss of poor Pat in 2019 and Peter receiving his diagnosis last summer, notwithstanding that, James spending the time that he did with you and Pat was something that I know meant an awful lot to him. On a personal level, Peter met the love of his life, Rosaline Rogers, at the beginning of the 1980s. To hear Peter talk, you would think that Rosaline could not wait to get a ring in that man's finger. Funnily enough, Rosaline has a slightly different version of events. Regardless, 39 years later, they were still looking after each other, and Rosaline, you were his one. They were married in 1982 and blessed with 2 wonderful daughters, Grace Anne and Mairead. To Peter, they were simply the greatest achievements of his life, and he would constantly, and quite rightly, say how proud he was of them. In return, he got 2 daddy's girls who loved him as much back. He was so happy to gain a son like Danny when Grace Anne got married, and Danny, you've been amazing. Then came the creme de la creme, the cherry on the cake, when Peter's grandson Dara arrived. Peter was like a kid in a sweet shop every time Dara was due to visit. You only have to look at the photos and videos, of which there are a few. Grace Anne, Steven Spielberg will be in touch shortly to see what they meant to each other. And secretly, secretly, Peter loved the fact that Dara called him Granny. As well as a love of family, Peter was conspicuous by the army of close friends he had. He was wonderful company. He was both jovial and avuncular. All my friends called him Uncle Peter. And he had a terrific circle of friends. You only had to walk into the Beechwood on a weekend to see Peter with his wee regular cabal of Callum, Jimmy, Dom, Doogie, Sean, Michael, Andy, Willie, Mark and Aidan. The laughter was constant and normally with Peter at the centre. For my own part, I was privileged to have spent almost every weekend with Peter for the last 26 years. We talked most days. He was fantastic company, but there was another side to Peter. That man could really talk, but he was also a terrific listener. In times of stress, he could give me gentle, sage advice and perhaps put things into perspective for me. But most importantly, he was always, always there for me. And I hope, in some small part, I was always there for you when you needed me, Pete. One of the things I loved about Peter was his occasional impromptu observations in life, otherwise known as Petercisms. To give you 2 very quick examples, on marital finance, he once said, "Remember, Stephen, what's mine is Rosalind's and what's hers is her own." Quite right, Rosie. Or my personal favourite, I don't know if you'd term it cultural national identity, when we were watching the Scotland football team, I would always try to wind him up by saying, "Peter, your team has just conceded a corner, or more often than not, another goal." Indignant, he would come back and say, That's not my team. I support the Republic. I said to him, Peter, but you were born in Glasgow. You're a true Scotsman, to which he came back with the riposte, Stephen, if a cat had a litter of kittens in a biscuit tin, does that make them biscuits? Genius. I still can't believe we're here. He was fighting to the end. There were some dark moments, but I can honestly say that any concerns that he had were not for himself. They were only for his girls, for Rosalind, Grace Anne and Mairead. I guess that's an example of true love. We did speak of a day like today, and he tried to give me strict instructions. There's been no tears and lots of laughter. I told him at the time the former just wasn't possible. He occupied too big a space in our hearts for there not to be tears. But we all have wonderful memories, so I'm sure there'll be copious amounts of laughter later. So to conclude, I'd like to paraphrase some lines from Peter's favourite poem. The words are pretty imperfect, but I hope that the sentiment is a fitting tribute to my old pal. Sorry. For all the comrades that ever you had, we are sorry for your going away. And all the loved ones you've left behind, they would wish you one more day to stay. But since it seems so off to be, there is a time to rise and a time to fall. We'll raise to you the parting glass. Good night and peace be with you always. Love you, Peter.
Thank you. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. On behalf of the whole parish community here at St. Columbkills in Rutherglen, I welcome you all with great affection this afternoon as you've come here for the Requiem Mass of a dear husband, a dear father, a dear grandfather, a brother, an uncle, a friend. Wherever you are and wherever you have come from, you are most very, very welcome here. We in the parish felt very privileged that we were asked to have. Dara's actually arguing with me just now. I must be going on too long. I'll just be a minute, I'll not be too long. We are delighted to have this Requiem Mass here. I think it's very fitting that this Requiem Mass is here. St. Columbkill, St. Columba spent time in Donegal and came here to Scotland to preach the faith and to be a presence of love here in this land. And I think there's something very beautiful about that for your family today to come here to this place in this church dedicated to this remarkable saint that changed the course of the Catholic history here in Scotland. And I'm sure for yourself, your father, your husband, your brother Peter has done that for you in a very particular way in your own life, has moulded and shaped you into the men and women that you are today. We have so much to give thanks to God for. But at a Requiem, we come to do three very simple but three very beautiful things. Firstly, to give thanks to God for the many graces and blessings that we have received from the deceased. And after that eulogy, it's very clear that we've got so much to give thanks to God for. Secondly, to comfort one another in our sadness, in our pain. Your hearts are broken today. Thirdly, but most importantly, to pray for his soul, that the Lord Jesus will be merciful to him, forgive any sins that he has committed, and welcome him into his loving embrace. And it's days like today that we realise how precious our Catholic faith is. It's the only thing that we can hold on to, the only thing that lasts, the only thing that endures to take us to that eternal place in the kingdom of heaven, where there are no more tears and no more pain, just eternal happiness. Let us pray. O God, who are mercy for sinners and the happiness of your saints, give, we pray, to your servant Peter, for whom we perform the fraternal offices of burial, a share with your chosen ones in the blessedness you give, so that on the day of resurrection, freed from the bonds of mortality, he may come before you face to face. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever. Amen. I'd like to invite the two members of the family who are going to lead us in the reading to please come forward. Please be seated.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all people a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all people and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth, for the Lord has said so. That day will be said, "See, this is our God in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord's my shepherd, I am not one. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me, the quiet waters by. My soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make within the paths of righteousness, in for his own name's sake. Yet though I walk in death's dark field, yet will I fear no ill, for thou art with me and thy rod and staff me comfort still. My table thou hast furnished, in presence of my foes. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be.
A reading from the book of the Apocalypse. I, John, heard a voice from heaven say to me, "Write down, happy are those who die in the Lord." Happy indeed, the Spirit says, now they can rest forever after their work, since their good deeds go with them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. If we have dined with Christ then we shall live with him. If we hold firm, we shall reign in him. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. On the first day of the week, two of the disciples who were on their way to a village called Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking together about all that had happened. Now, as they talked this over, Jesus himself came up and walked by their side. But something prevented them from recognizing him. He said to them, "What matters are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped short, their faces downcast. Then one of them, called Cleopas, answered him, "You must be the only person staying in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have been happening there these last few days." "What things?" he asked. "All about Jesus of Nazareth," they answered, "who proved he was a great prophet by the things he said and did in the sight of God and of the whole people, and how our chief priests and our leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death and had him crucified. Our own hope had been that he would be the one that would set Israel free. And this is not all. 2 whole days have gone by since it all happened, and some women from our group have astounded us. They went to the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find the body, they came back to tell us what they had seen, a vision of angels who declared he was alive. Some of our friends went to the tomb and found everything exactly as the women had reported, but of him they saw nothing." Then he said to them, "You foolish men, so slow to believe the full message of the prophets. Was it not ordained that the Christ should suffer and so enter into glory? Then, starting with Moses and going through all of the prophets, he explained the passages throughout the scriptures that were about himself. When they drew near to the village to which they were going, he made as if to go on, but they pressed him to stay with them. 'It is nearly evening,' they said, 'and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. Now while he was with them at table, he took the bread and said the blessing and broke it and handed it to them. And their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he had vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, 'Did not our hearts burn within us as he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?' They set out that instant and returned to Jerusalem, where they have found the 11 assembled together with their companions, and said to them, 'Yes, it is true. The Lord has risen and appeared to Simon.' Then they told their story of what had happened on the road, and they had recognized him at the breaking of bread." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated for a moment. As has become so clear to me in these days since Peter's death, the outpouring of emotion, of love and support to his family is testament of how you all feel today. This constant presence of love that you have known in your life is no longer with you in the form that you have become so accustomed, not least to Rosaline and the girls and Peter's very close family. You are like the couple in the gospel, the pair of friends whose hearts are broken. There's a detail in this gospel from Luke's account that does go easily go unnoticed, We hear that they're going in the opposite direction of where they actually live. They just want to run away. This person that they'd put so much trust in is no longer with them. For them, of course, it was Jesus. They hadn't witnessed his resurrection. Their hearts were broken. They just wanted to get away from it all. And in the midst of this pain, in the midst of this suffering that can so easily bruise and harm us all, Jesus is with them. And by God, he is with you in these days and has been journeying with you since I have come into the life of this family. I've been here for 4 years. And it's so very sad to welcome this family for this purpose back to this church. So many of their very close relations have made that journey now back to the Father. And I can only begin to understand how difficult this must be to come yet again. But the story doesn't end there. Just as in the gospel today, Jesus is present to the brokenhearted, and then they recognize him in the breaking of bread, a prelude, of course, to the Holy Eucharist, to the Mass, the thing that transcends space and time. We cross the threshold of hope from the main street here and come into this heavenly place where heaven meets earth. And that happens every time we gather as a community of faith around the altar of God to pray for those that have gone before us, to pray for ourselves in our own pilgrim journey in life. We give thanks to God for having that great gift. St. Paul says in his letter to the Thessalonians that we do not grieve like those without any faith. I often wonder how people who have no faith manage to get through the day, especially in dealing with someone that they have loved that has died. How blessed are we to come here today, that through our prayers and through the work of the hands of Jesus in me in a few moments in the Holy Mass, that sacrifice offered for Peter, that he will be rewarded for his goodness, the good deeds that we heard about in the eulogy, and of course re-echoed by St. Paul's letter in the second reading. We pray that his good deeds will go with him now, and that the Lord Jesus will gently wipe away every tear from our eyes, and that when adversity, when difficulty, when the cross comes, when our human nature, which is so very fragile, that the Lord Jesus will be guiding us home to him. We only have to open our hearts. Let's be like the friends in the gospel today and recognize the Lord Jesus in the breaking of bread and in one another. May the Lord support us all the day long, till the shades lengthen and the evening comes, and the fever of life is over, and the Lord's work is done. Then may the Lord give us all safe dwelling, and holy rest, and peace at last. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. I'd like to invite the members of the family who are going to lead us in the bidding prayers to please come forward to the amble. Please stand.
Turning to our Heavenly Father, we present to him our needs and petitions this day, confident that the Lord Jesus, who always hears the prayers of his children, will answer them this day.
We pray for our Uncle Peter, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he might be raised upon this last day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our family and friends who have gone before us in the faith, especially Peter's mother and father, his brothers, John and Patrick, niece, Maureen, and nephews, John and Liam, that we will enjoy unending light and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for Peter and all his family, wife Roseline, daughters Grisanne and Mairead, son-in-law Danny and his beloved grandson Dara, his sister Maureen, brothers Eddie and James, and all his extended family and friends, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We take a moment now to turn to Mary, our Blessed Mother, our great advocate, the one that stood at the foot of the cross to see her son in agony, but her joy was great when he rose from the dead. We implore her motherly help for all our needs as we pray as one family. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen. Lord our God, you have heard the prayers of your children this day. Grant them, for we make them in your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the offertory.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love. There is only one God, there is only one King. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love. Men for the glory of God, purchased by his precious Son. Born with the right to be free, Jesus the victory has won. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love.
Please stand. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. The praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant Peter may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of
your glory.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes, in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Let us kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Joseph, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Peter, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who is united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, may we merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
Please stand. At the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not in our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with you today.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Await a Saviour, the Lord Jesus, who will change our mortal bodies to conform with his glorified body. We now come to the reception of Holy Communion. You're invited to come forward through the centre aisle. If you're unable to receive Holy Communion for whatever reason and wish a blessing, then please indicate this to me by placing your arm across your chest. Be very welcome to come forward for a blessing, should you wish.
I, the Lord of sky and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall
As we praise your name. Golden Rose, Queen of Ireland, and troubles cease. As we kneel with love before you, Lady of Knock, my Queen of Peace. Though your message wasn't spoken, still the truth in silence lies. As we gaze upon your vision, and the truth I try to find, here I stand with John the teacher and with Joseph at your side. As I see the Lamb of God on the altar glorified, golden rose, Queen of Ireland, all my cares and troubles cease. As we kneel with love before you, Lady of Knock, my Queen of Peace. And the Lamb will conquer, and the woman clothed in the sun will shine her light on everyone. And the Lamb will conquer, and the woman clothed in the sun will shine her light on everyone. Golden rose, Queen of Ireland, all my cares and troubles cease. As we kneel with love before you, of Knock, my Queen of Peace, Lady of Knock, my Queen of
let us pray. Please stand. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that that strengthened by it, her brother Peter, may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Just before the final commendation, just to thank the Gildea family for preparing such a worthy liturgy for Peter this afternoon, and to thank you on their behalf for all of your many kindnesses to them. We're very fortunate that the restrictions have lifted, and in such a big church like St. Columb Kills, we're able to host and accommodate a large number of people. This is particularly pertinent for our Sunday Eucharist. So now all of the restrictions have been lifted, and we have five Masses over the weekend. And I would encourage you so much, if you have been away from Mass for whatever reason and forever how long, to come back with all your heart. As I said at the beginning of Mass, our faith is the only thing that we can hold on to in times of trouble, in times of difficulty, to move us on in that pilgrim journey that we are all on together in the hope of reaching the heavenly kingdom one day. May the Lord Jesus touch your heart this day and comfort you and gently wipe away every tear from your eye. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Peter. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again with the love of Christ, which conquers all things and destroys even death itself.
Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid, hasting to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. May Christ who called you take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's sight. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Eternal rest give him to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul, receive his soul, and present him to God the Most High.
Thank you.
Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way. Sometimes the road seems long, my energy is spent. Then, Lord, I think of you, and I am given strength. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way. Stones often bar my path, and there are times I fall. But you are always there to help me when I call. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way. Just as you calmed the wind and walked upon the sea, conquer my living war, the storms that threaten me. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Take my hands and guide me on my way. Sometimes the road seems long, my energy is spent. Then, Lord, I think of you, and I am given strength. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way. Stones often bar my path, and there are times I fall. But you were always there for me to help me when I call. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way. Just as you calmed the wind and walked upon the sea, conquer my living Lord, the storms that threatened me. Walk with me, O my Lord, through the darkest night and brightest day. Be at my side, O Lord. Hold my hand and guide me on my way.